those of you who know how to pray, please pray, please pray. Comment on the comment section. Comment with your short prayer. I just sent a request to people right now to pray for us. Somebody's prayer just went. I'm doing good in you.
I'm super.
Beautiful. Let me do official greetings and welcome to everybody. Family, thank you for taking your time today to tune in to this beautiful show that is called The Predestined. The Morero wa show, it is to remind you that God has planned with your life and it is not over until God says it's over. Today in our studio, of course, we are joined by none other than Refiwe Modisele, and of course we'll be talking discussing about the topic that is entitled self-esteem. I know some of you believe in self-esteem when you're ill in your grade 3, grade 4, grade 5, but today we're going to make sure that we unpack it. And those of you by lowering your self-esteem is crushed, is destroyed, I promise you after this session today it's going to be restored. It is from our heart to your heart. We want to say to you, we love you. We take this time to share with you. And please, of course, if you have a question, you can drop it there on the comment section. We'll do our best to answer you. Refiwe, what a beautiful name.
Hi, Kevin.
Thank you. Rite. So, Refiwe, I know my sister right now as we speak, your brand is global. You are no longer South African brand, you are received even internationally. So, and then for us who knows Sotho, Setswana, Sepedi, we know the name Refiwe means what. So people international who don't know what's the meaning of the name Refiwe, how go about you? So please tell them what's the meaning of the name.
Refiwe ke Motswana, but she grew up speaking a lot of Sesotho. But Refiwe is we have been given. So that's what my name is. It means we have been given, meaning that I am a gift to the world.
Wow. And we receive you because you are a gift to us.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And speaking of global, I think a lot of people didn't actually know that I went global in the year 2012. So the global thing isn't something new. So self-esteem is how you view yourself. It is the opinion that you have of yourself. It's how you feel about yourself.
So now, growing up as a child in your community, before you can even go to preschool or go and do your one back then, Ghana Kotsaho never needs a standard one. Growing up with other children.
Then we go to grade 3, which is standard 1 back then standard 2, then 3, then 4, then 5, then 6, 7, 8, 9, then
1. Yeah, so now, before you went to standard 1, growing up in community, of course, you know when children, when bana bahula in the community, you always look forward to you against each other, especially when we wanna cause a pain on another person. Look at things, it's a we can use to tease them. You know, when I was growing up, they used to tease me about my big head, and in the process of time, I learned to accept my big
head. Where is it?
There you go. You know,
I'm sure it's not an it's not an empty big head, because the difference is that when they say you have a big head, you come, you respond back and say, well, it's not an empty big head. That's one thing for sure. Yeah. It's got lots of things in it.
Yeah.
And my experience of, I think, let's start to grade one. Let's start with grade one, because grade one, we are kids. It's age maybe 6 or 7. I started in school when we were about 6 or 7. Uh-huh. And you don't really have an idea of what the world is going to make you feel like to a certain degree. Kids are very oblivious to a lot of things. You know, we don't pay attention. And obviously, it's only as the years go by and you start to integrate yourselves amongst with other people, is it more evident, or, you know, how it is that you start to identify with yourself. So, just stand one is like what, age 7 or 8? That's not 7 or 8, it's age, let me see, because I started at age 6 in school. My grade one was 6 years old. So, standard one, probably be what, 6, 7, 8. I was ages old by then. And ages old, you are, I think, becoming more aware of what people do to you. And I mean, all my life, I've had people speak about me. I've had people make commentary, because originally I'm from Soweto. I was born in Soweto. And, you know, we moved to the suburbs when I was about, I think, around about 4 years old. That's when we moved to the suburbs. And township has a different experience of how it is that it presents you to the rest of the world, because obviously it's a black community, but among other, they have a lot to say and say in face. In the metropolitan, it's more integrated. You know, there's a lot more mix and people are a lot more accommodating to accept you or about the person that you are. So the contrast is very different. Coming from township, you know, to go into a space where it is more acceptable to be you, still didn't exempt me from, you know, questioning who I was in the space of society and how I needed to feel about myself. But my greatest blessing was the fact that I came from a family that kept me very grounded and very strong in terms of being able to instill a sense of self. As for me to know what I can feel, you understand? And not really look for that validation going outside. And it's a tough thing, because we don't all come from good homes. We don't all come from homes where your parents are going to affirm the person that you are from a grassroots level. It's tough. And then you have exterior factors. Say, I'm going to because when I was young, I was a bunkum. You know, and you grow up with that thing, not out of confidence. But then what? And then people have different perception or saying what it is that they want to say about you. And I kind of, you know, creates questions for you as a child, because you don't understand. You're being told one thing, going, how to again, it's another thing. What no, mama. This and that, or whatever the case is. But I think for me, as I said, my saving grace was the fact that I could go back home and constantly be reassured and affirmed of the child that I was. So, and I didn't need to look for love outside. So my introduction to love started from Kunkung. Had I not received that, I would have not been able to build my character, which is something that I always, always, always talk about, that the foundation of where you come from is a kind of like a prerequisite of the kind of person that you're going to be going forward. So if the seeds are planted quite young, you have more of a chance that you will turn out actually blossom, because then you make the decisions as to how it is that you want, you know, to feel as a person. But just karung. Why it always starts from your foundation, who are you surrounded by? And yes, my foundation was amazing and exceptional. But it doesn't mean that I was exempt, because growing up, yes, there was that. But it's a different scenario. I'm now faced with a beast, where it is that I need to answer questions, where it is that I need to make sense of the information that is now coming to me in terms of how it is I'm going to be judged from a society that gives you a system and says, this is how a little girl should be, this is a representation of what a bad girl should be. So it will affect you. It will affect you. But I think for me, as I said, I was oblivious to a lot and very unaware of what was happening around me because I had a strong sense of self from the beginning. I think my self-esteem really was tested through growing up in the years when obviously I had to integrate more with other children. And then, you know, different children are saying different things, but honestly, truly speaking, I think that, you know, it helped me develop a very strong backbone and the assurance of knowing and validating who I was beyond looking for validation from society was very important for me. Environments, people allowed me to express myself the way that I needed to, though the world wanted to close me up. And I gave people an opportunity to define me for me, you know. The failure within the process had to, it was like a gradual build-up, and that's the thing. Self-esteem is not an instant thing. It is a gradual build-up. You have to start somewhere. And it doesn't mean that all the confidently or I'm not confident 24/7. So naturally, I'm strong. So yeah. I would not allow people to take anything to me. And it's like, the more unkotlang, the more I'm going to say, oh, okay. Is it you and me? That's how I fight my battles, is that I've had to fight my battles of self-esteem by shutting out the noise. Had I listened to a lot of what people were trying to say to me in bringing me down, I would have never become the refugee that was now breaking boundaries in the modeling industry, who's now become so prevalent in the entertainment industry, and, you know, explore the many facets of my life and just become so vocal in also redefining the ideology of what beauty is. Sometimes in life you need to be able to make sense of things for yourself as opposed to letting society make sense of it for you.
So Refilwe, I know, like, now as I'm speaking, one of the things that you are well known about doing, you are a model, you know, recognized locally. Recognized locally and internationally. So many people, of course, they don't know that you started doing modeling at the age of 30. You were still young when you started this, you know? And I know that it happened that somebody asked you to come and do a photo shoot, of which in the beginning your mom was not in favor of that, you know? So I want you to take us through that from the beginning, how it started, and why was your mom so much protective? King Sena Sabahaka to say my child did not do that. And what happened? Like, what is it that made it that you can agree and say, go and do this?
Yeah. I think the thing is, modeling is, first of all, a very superficial industry. And I'm going to say it, it's an extremely superficial industry where, you know, your looks are the ideology of what should be painted to the world. So you can only imagine at age 13, first of all, as a 13-year-old, a teenager, what does a teenager know about being ill? And also because my mom understood how vulnerable I would be in such an industry at such a very, very young age. I mean, modeling is very cutthroat. It's very cutthroat. They want you to be a specific something, like the category of where it is that they want to place you, and you should be able to fit that mold. So if you don't fit that mold, they tend to not really be accommodative of it. So you must remember that it was the year, 1999. The year 1999, where first and foremost, there was no reference as to, you know, people with albinism in the modeling space. So you can only imagine, like, from a parent's perspective, Oriana Nahufila Joan as Mutsuadi, you know, and why one I can, you know, but to answer my lena in spaces and were people going to be accommodated to it, were they going to receive me well, and it's just, you know, the idea that modeling is very superficial. It is a, it's almost like a, I don't say beauty contest because that's a whole different beast altogether, but it's like your level of beauty is being gauged up against everybody else, and it's what is being sold to the rest of society. But there's no reference. So the hardest part was that there was nobody that looked like me at the time. And so if you don't have a reference, how are you going to feel comfortable about putting your child in that space? You know what I mean? And I was young. 13 is a very young age to go into it, and especially for an industry of that nature is unforgiving. So I think more than anything, she needed to protect me from, you know, the judgment that just comes from it, because it was something that was so new. Obviously, there was a lot of questions that went come with it. And just also the attention, you know, how is the attention going to affect me as Refiwe? And yes, she was very resistant to it at first, but, you know, by the grace of God, you know, when destiny is something that God has defined for you and the purpose that he wants to fulfill, he'll just do his thing, you know. And that's exactly what happened, and went into it, and it was my first shoot, so I was very excited. I was very young and naive, so I didn't understand what it is that I was going into. For me, you know, what it meant, I didn't understand what it is it meant, you know. And for a 13-year-old who had never identified herself as beautiful, this was groundbreaking. This for me was like a subtle message to say that you qualify to be just as beautiful as any other person that is out there. And that's exactly what happened. We did the shoot. I felt incredible. I felt amazing. It was the first time, I think, in my life where I didn't need to question my beauty, like, authentically.
Wow.
And I say that because the response that it came from, they were so fascinated and so on, but it didn't make me get a big head. That's the difference. It didn't mean that I now got a colossal head. What? Give me my attention. No, it didn't. Instead, it just gave me a sense of cushioning, you know, to say that, you know, my kind of beauty can also be deemed as beautiful for the rest of the world. I need to teach the world that beauty comes in different forms. And I did stop modeling, you know, after 13, because obviously the books were a focus. But, you know, as we say, when purpose has its way in your life, it's gonna call you. So after the trick, fortunate enough, the streets were calling again. Yes, I was in tertiary, but I was scouted, you know, from my first year. Just as I went out, I was scouted to do more modeling, to do more things. And that's when I did a shoot for Vegas School of Advertising. And then came across, you know, your David Clanes. I then, you know, did your Clive Rundells. I did your fashion weeks, your this, your that. And eventually I started blossoming. But the thing is, what people don't understand is that within all of that, I still had to go through the turmoil of constantly being judged and judged in the context of still. When you go into a space where people don't understand something and are not accustomed to it, it becomes very difficult for them to just take it in very warmly. We are from a system that is very comfortable with what it knows as opposed to what it does not know. So how we campus spacing here, you know, I kind of had to fight for my place. But also shut out the noise, because I got called names. I got called ugly, I got called ghost, I got called pig, I got called all sorts of names. And the worst part was that happened in, I think, 2012, when I broke out globally as Africa's first successful model with albinism, South Africa's first model with albinism. So when I broke out, I got a lot of pack. I got, why is she wearing a wig? Why is she not using natural hair? Why she got makeup on, blah, blah, blah. But because I knew me, my sense of self, who I was, and whose child I belong to, and whose God I serve, nothing would deter me from feeling any different to who I am. And yes, those experiences happen. And it's not to say that I'm still not immune. It doesn't mean that Kirambo, no. Because
yeah,
this one, yeah.
Yeah,
it doesn't mean Kirambo. There are things that still happen in life that tend to, you know, affect your self-esteem. The moments in your life where, you know, you used to really feel hot, and then you get older, and then you're like, oh my God, what's happening? I no longer am as cute as I used to feel when I was younger. But you always need to remind yourself of who you are, whose child you are, the heart that God gave you, and the characteristics that make you beyond all of this.
Self-esteem. Let's unmask this a little bit, ne? And then talk a little more about your journey, especially in the entertainment industry. One of the things that you are raising now is that you've been received more international. You've been recognized more internationally. And then look at, of course, there's been some sort of rejections. One of the things that I know is that you used to go to auditions. Let's take, for example, they would say, we are looking for a product girl, you know, a robot one, you get that space. And I'll say that.
We're looking for a pretty girl.
They look at you and they be like, you're not robot one. And that on its own, you don't belong.
Yeah.
You don't belong. So, as an individual, I consider you as a force. If I was speaking in the biblical context, I would consider you as a force that caused the walls of Jericho to fall, you know. So
and that's exactly what happened.
So how did you deal with that? But how would you handle it? How did you deal?
I think the thing is, when you know your identity, like, identity is so key. And I cannot stress this. Like, I cannot stress this enough. Knowing umu Africa, where your roots run, who you are, who your parents are, I think it is so important in building your identity. And when you affirm in your identity, nobody can tell you anything.
Okay.
So for me, the brief that says, well, we're looking for a black chick, and you rock up at an audition and you're not exactly the black chick, you're still not gonna tell me that I'm black. Both my parents are black as they come, and because my skin is not the same color as everybody else, does not make me any less black. It just makes me a different definition of what's never been explored nor acknowledged. So the walls of Jericho definitely had to come down, because I refused the narrative that was constantly preached to people. It's the same thing as the process of learning. There are many things as people, you know, growing in Zerowana that we need to unlearn, and that is so important, like just the unlearning process. And the unlearning process means that as much as you're born to be told, and that's why the miracle had to come down, because for me, I could not understand for the life of me how you are telling me, you're telling me I'm born in the way I am. Okay? You're telling me that I'm not validated to be black enough. Who are you to tell me that? Who are you? Tell me that when I know who my ancestors are and where I'm from.
Yeah.
So, how was going to break loose for me? Like, how was just going to break loose? Because that's the thing. I just had this thing in me that challenges a lot of the thinking, a lot of what people say. You know, I don't just take it into it because people are saying that. I question them, which is very important, which is something that we should be doing just generally. And that's why it was important for me to challenge a lot, to challenge the ideology of beauty, to challenge how we should feel about ourselves as people with albinism, to challenge how I should feel as a black person in a white person's skin. I could choose to hate myself, but I cannot hate myself if I'm a representation of a complete human being. And that's the most important part, is that I'm a complete human being. I lack nothing. My lack of melanin doesn't make me lack any characteristics. And that's a constant reminder. That is a constant reminder that you need to have, that you need to keep within yourself, even as you go forward, because the world is always going to talk. The world is always going to talk. Listen, you'll never make people happy. But now I always say, how can it happen? And that's that. A very harsh reality that you need to come to is that people are not your alpha and omega.
Yeah.
Ultimately, when you're peeling for you, we're all going to slow down. You're peeling, darling. You're peeling, you know, to fulfill a purpose, you know, and the greater purpose is, you know, keeping in a sense of self and how it is that God made you. Self-acceptance is so. And these are just some of the fundamentals that are important in grounding you in your self-esteem and who you are. And as I said, I'm not immune to experiences of life, even at this age. I'm 34, but it doesn't mean the things that don't knock me. And it's not superficial things. There are things that happen as well. And I mean superficial, I mean in terms of beauty. It's not just beauty that will knock your self-esteem. Experiences in life will knock your self-esteem. Where you are in life, what you have not accomplished in life, how shape the batwa, oh, you know, those are so many factors, like, that just build around your self-esteem. It's not always the aesthetic, because you could be absolutely gorgeous but be so empty in so many ways. Those things are, you know, things that determine your self-esteem as a person. But at the end of the day, the one thing that I've learned is, you know, look at the deeper sometimes. Yeah. And look at the situations. You know, how do you do it? Like when I have a person who is already I get really tricky about that. But when you sit down and you assess, is this the time for me to receive what I need to receive in my life? Then that will give you a sense of ease in your self-esteem.
Yeah.
To understand that it may be you. It's just the timing of when something needs to happen. Just because you don't have this house, just because you don't have this car, doesn't make you any less of a person. Just because you don't have that specific job doesn't make you less of a person. There are things which you need to develop within yourself to understand not according to the way you want, but how a higher power wants for those things to happen.
Wow, that's beautiful. Now let's go to one of your self-esteem quotes. Now, when I was busy doing my research, I came across something that is beautiful. And this is what you said. This is what you said.
Well done.
I was watching. You said, if you follow everyone else, you'll become like everyone else. You'll look the same, dress the same, be the same. You'll blend in and never be seen. Please unpack that to us. Grata Patiama fellow, where you say, and never be seen. Today, review. Wabonaha.
I think, you know, there's something called sheep culture, right? And sheep culture is gauging yourself up against what media is portraying to you or how people want you to be. If you follow everyone else, and following everyone else means that you'll see a refilwe and say, my darling, you don't know what it took for me to be in the shoes that I'm in, that you want to follow, but yet you want to follow that route. Won't make any sense. because everybody is ordained or given as the purpose that they're meant to serve in their life. How will you be able to identify what it is that you're meant to do or who it is that you're meant to become if you're so busy following somebody else? And you don't know what the person did to get to where they are. You don't know the journey. You've never understood the shoes that they've had to fall. So if you follow that, what is going to be your lesson in following that? Instead of sometimes sitting back, yes, assessing your own strengths, looking at your own abilities and saying, okay, what can I be inspired by this person? What can I grasp from this person that can inspire me? Not necessarily follow in that person, because that's a different principle. To follow the footsteps of somebody else is a big thing, because it means that you are living in the shadow and not your truth and who you want to be. It's amazing. It's better when you are inspired by a person and say, I take inspiration from this person, because you know we need a sense of motivation in any aspect, in whatever that we do. Nobody is an island. There are people that that have inspired me, you know, to become the person that I need to become. But within all of that, the unfortunate part is that I've had to fix for myself, because nobody has channeled this refuge. So maybe this refuge was channeled to inspire other children and other people, you know, in the journey going forward. But following everybody else means that you are a sheep. You're not using your ability to create the person that you need to be and what it is that you need to fulfill. Meaning that you are doing an injustice to the God that made you just as you are, wants you to fulfill a specific role that is made for you and not another person.
Wow. So
it is key.
Yeah, so one of the moments in your career that when you were seen, one of the highlights is that you were the face of Legit. Tell me about that.
That quote was from Legit. And the quote got before was from Legit, and I think they just saw it fit. You know, it fitted everything that was to represent in the future.
Wow, I didn't know that it was from Legit. So
that quote was from Legit.
okay, we give credit. So I know you were one of Oprah Winfrey top 15 power list.
Yes. Since we're talking about self-esteem, and I think a lot of people think, she must have gotten a big head after that. Can I tell you, when I got the news, it came and it went by so quickly. Because one thing I'm very cognizant of is to not allow things become really like to blow me out of proportion to a degree that I forget my sense of self. That's something I'm very, very aware and very alert when it comes to such things. Because the unfortunate part is that when you hear news like that, there are people who, you know, their self-esteem becomes overinflated. It's very good for the self-esteem because it's a boost to say, we see and acknowledge the strides that you're making in terms of the industry that you are changing, which is a massive boost. But then again, you need to be able to balance yourself out and say, okay, this is an acknowledgement, pat on the back, but, you know, let's also move along swiftly because life is very long. It's an amazing acknowledgement which I hold very dear to my heart. But I've always been very hard on myself as well in terms of understanding that, yes, things will happen now, but that doesn't mean it's the be-all and end-all of you. There's still a very long journey to go through and a lot more to accomplish. So, on to the next one. Hare.
Yes. So many people, maybe they think Repile Modisele is only an actor, you know, a model, and they don't know who Repile Modisele. You know, you are educated. You've been to
Masi. Self-esteem.
Hello, Ref. Yeah,
yes,
I'm saying thing, go varsity college, you obtained five distinctions. Like distinction it's something on its own. And now as you're gonna speak about that, please speak to grade 12s out there by learning right now due to the COVID-19 pandemic. They are so stressed, you know, and when they look at themselves, they think that at the end of the year, they won't make it in their examinations. As some old Eluri, you want to obtain the five distinctions. What is your advice to people by Eluri that will be writing their examination at the end of the year this year?
Sure. You know, I think the one thing that I stick by is never allow your circumstances to define the person that you need to become, right? We're in a situation where there's COVID-19 and so many things are uncertain, but when you're determined to reach an end goal and see yourself in a better place, then you push for whatever that you desire. My five distinctions were not easy, and to be an overall academic achiever was something that was not easy. I was going through a lot in my final year, you know. I had personal challenges in my final year. I almost didn't finish that year, actually, because, like, in terms of my, I think I only went about a month into my final year because there was no money to send me to school. So that could have been enough to knock me out of my own self-esteem and just be like, you know what, let me give up. But because I come from a very beautiful home, and my mom refused, you know, to allow, you know, I'm not going to go to school because of disappointment. It was one of those things of, you know, come hell or high water, you make things happen. And I think that's the attitude that you have to develop, you know, in developing yourself and who you want to be and how you want to feel and where it is that you're going, is come hell or high water, you make things happen, because God does not put desires in your heart, you know, for you to fail or for you to overlook them. He doesn't do that. And yes, we come from circumstances. Some people will be like, you're so privileged. A lot of people don't know my story. I don't exactly come from privilege. I've had to work 100 times hard to become the person that I am. And I still work 100 times hard even today. People think I sit on a cushion. I don't sit on a cushion. I still have to prove myself 100 times more than the person who just, you know, has maybe, I don't want to say an easier journey, but there are people that have it easier, you know. And if you're in grade 12, please know that COVID-19 is not definitive of your future.
Okay.
COVID-19 was never definitive of your outcomes, of the person that you need to become in your focus.
Okay.
Yes, but when, how are you using your time? Are you gonna let people spoon food feed you? Because after matric, there's no spoon feeding, let me tell you. When you get into the real world, you get stuff done yourself. You push yourself. Nobody is going to do that for you. So you need to learn that lesson now.
Yeah.
So study hard, keep a good mindset. It's always a good thing to be in a good frame of mind. Get in check with yourself. If you're not okay, speak to somebody. There are people out there who are more than willing to hear out, you know, to give you assistance, you know, because there are a lot of people who are afraid to say, I can't or I need help. But I look right, not really right. And pride, I choose the next issue. It doesn't.
That's true.
It doesn't hurt to ask. As black people, we have this very ugly tendency of assuming that a person is going to look down on you when you ask. There's absolutely nothing wrong with asking. Because if you don't ask, where will you receive your answers?
Wow. Beautiful. So now, Revilo, Arbonele ka you as being a musician. Many people, they don't know that you are a musician. Singer. You're a singer, but I think maybe be the first person in my shows, be the best person to sing for us.
You know, baby. You don't have me to sing.
Lockdown, that's a sing.
Okay.
Sing us your favorite song.
Okay. Where do I go? You think your self esteem is wrong? It can't in. Something about the combat, actually, that's another thing, is that for self-esteem, you always need to conquer your fears, and it doesn't mean that I don't have fear. Singing has been one of the biggest gifts that I've had, but I've always kind of been afraid to pursue it because I know how doggy-dog that part of the industry is, and yeah, I just need to really have the vodka. It's there. Yeah. It's just taking me a while to get to the place that I need to
get to. I should be some requests to get to Ina. You wanna
add... Barring. Okay, barring.
Ave Maria.
I
see Ave Maria by Beyonce, Amanda Black, Dashi. Two.
Yo. Shoo. Oh. What did they say? Amanda Black?
Amanda Black is Ashley. And then Beyonce Ave Maria. If you don't know those songs, maybe you can sing any from one of the artists that you know, any song.
Okay. Here goes.
Yeah.
Okay, here goes. We build sandcastles that washed away high medieval ground. And I walked away. Oh, although I promised that I couldn't stay, baby, every promise don't work away. Oh, babe, every promise don't work away. Pictures smashed on the counter from our last encounter. Wow. Pictures snatched out the frame. Boy, I call your name. Oh, I have this one. Is it all praise, baby, every promise don't work away. No, babe, every promise don't work away.
Oh, wow. That's so beautiful. You can even see what the reflection.
I'm so rusty. You guys, you sing with no voice warm-ups. I'm so rusty right now.
Look at the love that you are receiving on the comment section.
I can't even all that love.
More love.
I can't see this love. I can't even see the love.
You sing beautiful. Ravine, we are approaching the end of our session, eh? But of course, you can see behind the screen, there goes the beautiful you see, the beautiful you.
Yeah.
And then we also have one of your, I don't know whether to call it greatest one, but it's great on its own, you know. So tell us about the movie White Gold, and also How did you find yourself ending up at LA because of the movie? Tell us about
it. Yeah. So, Ash, I received the most amazing opportunity, which I auditioned for, because yes, a lot of
like, I didn't audition for that role. Listen, my ass auditioned. I auditioned for that role. I fought for that role. Damn it. So there's a movie called Ryan Gold, which, you know, the story is an albinism-based story, but, initially I would have never really taken it because I tend to shy away from very streamlined albinism-based stories because I feel like a person should have the freedom to tell any story whatsoever, not because of albinism, that I should be stuck in albinism. So essentially what happened is I got the brief from my management and they said, hey, you know, we know you're very sensitive about certain things, but would you be willing to, you know, audition? And I read the script. I loved the script. The story resonated so much inside of me and I saw what it could do, you know, not just for me, but for a lot of people who see a person with albinism and don't know their story. You know, it's not my story. It's somebody else's story in Tanzania, but the reality of what happens in Africa and potentially other parts of the world, and it needed somebody to tell that story. So for me, it was a challenge as well because I wanted to prove myself as an actress. It's not the first time that I act. I'm not a shock for a lot of people. A lot of people are like, oh no, but we didn't know that she acts. I've been acting. My first acting role was actually on Generations. And I was just one of the office workers. I was an extra, you know. A lot of people don't know that I did Mzansi Love, which were the short stories that used to be on ED. I did Check Coast, which was on Vuzu. I did Tell Me Sweet Something, the film with Nomsa Mombatha and Maps Maponyane. Yo, there's like, I did an international series called Of Kings and Prophets, you know. So I've had a long history of acting, but never a lead role. And the opportunity came along, I auditioned, I totally knocked it out of the park. I was everything that they wanted beyond. And then they were like, oh my God, V, you got the role. And I cried tears of joy. God help me. And you know, and yeah. And then they came to South Africa, a British crew came to South Africa to come shoot. South Africans were cast for it. The likes of Opri Magola, Shadi Chauke, Olotu Zulu, just to name a few people who were in the film. And we shot the film, and this was last year in September, in between also doing Bundle's ceremonies, funny enough. It was during her 2-wedding ceremony, her baby shower, so I had a lot of my plate because now it was shooting the film and I'm getting to big sister gear to do all of that. And I guess it happened and I waited for the film to come out and it was ready by January, sent through to the film festival, the Pan-African Film Festival, got called to LA. Yes. And we'd also been nominated Best Humanitarian Short Film, Best Short Narrative Film. Out of 19 nominees, so yeah, we were 19 nominees in total, so we competed literally with 18 other people, and our film took it, and it now is a Oscar qualifier film, basically, for consideration, so it could be considered to go into the Oscars for 2021. So that was what it was, and Why Gold was just an important story that talks about you know, the injustices of people with albinism, and especially in Tanzania, where you find that a lot of people have their hands chopped off and their body parts being sold to the black market for as high as $75,000, and this that is very real. So Why Gold addresses that issue, but it also has other things that speak around it in terms of the relationship that Mensa has with her father, a father and daughter relationship, you know, whether the law takes its course when it comes to certain things. It speaks about humanity and so many other aspects. So White Gold isn't just about albinism or albinism awareness, but it touches on many other aspects of just life and the experiences of people and how we see ourselves, self-esteem, how we see ourselves, how the world sees us, and what it is that we need to also find within ourselves as human beings when it comes to the caring of other humanity. So yeah, also made it to the African Film Festival, which is in Dallas, Texas. That's next month in June. Unfortunately, we cannot travel. Yeah, it's showing there. It's showing there.
They must postpone it.
Man, they can't really postpone, you know. Film festivals kind of sort of have to do their run, and especially in the circumstances, you need to kind of keep things going. And I mean, they already had planned. So I'm sure all the other film festivals are currently postponed because the film is supposed to do a 12-month to 18-month film festival before it is commercially available. And yeah, so yes, and then feature film is also in the woodworks because it was just a short film. Now they're actually doing the full, like, 1 hour and a half, 2 hours, three, maybe. Oh my God. So that's something to look forward to.